Hello. Welcome to another exciting episode of AJ Has a Sad and Pathetic Life, this time in December. Let it be known that this is my first video in 2021, and it's talking about 2020 again. I started off the month watching The Queen's Gambit, and it was actually pretty awesome. I had no idea I would ever become so engaged in chess matches of all things, but here we are. But the reason why this is so engaging to me is because of how everything is developed. The chess aspect is merely a subplot and coping mechanism for the main character Beth, who is struggling with addiction and not having a family. Queen's Gambit deals with such a serious topic so respectively, while staying tonally consistent throughout the whole thing. And even with that, every episode never felt repetitive, at least for me. Also, Queen is fitting because Anya Taylor-Joy is in this. Then I watched Singing in the Rain. This became my go-to make-me-feel-happy movie so fast. I love every song, I love every dance, I love every character, everything. I love everything. This movie is everything, I love it. Then I watched Die Hard for the first time. Yes, first time. This is full proof of how movies don't always have to be deep and thought-provoking in order to be enjoyable. This is probably the most exciting movie I've ever seen. Die Hard kind of pushes the envelope for action movies by creating a character that can actually get his ass handed to him. Every time John gets hit, you feel it. Every time he walks when his feet are covered in glass, I can't help but to cringe. But it's always so satisfying when he just gets right back up. Not for himself, but to protect everyone in the building. All the while also being kind of an annoying asshole, but a lovable one. That's fantastic character development. Yeah, anyway, catch me watching this a lot. And also, is it a Christmas movie? It's a who gives a shit and just watch it anytime movie. I'm tired of your stupid debates and dead memes. And then I watched I'm Your Woman and... Bleh! I was genuinely looking forward to this, not only because the trailer looked cool, but because I'm a Rachel Brosnahan stan at heart. She's great in Mrs. Maisel, she's great in everything. But this is one of the most boring movies I've seen in recent memory. I don't necessarily mean boring as in I couldn't give a shit about what was going on, though that is part of the case. I mean boring as in if you were to ask me what this movie was about, I don't know what I'd be able to tell you. Like her husband goes missing or something, and like she goes on the run and some guys help her. I mean okay, but like, who cares? And I'd at least give the movie some credit if anything fucking happened. Don't get me wrong, I usually love movies where not much happens, but here it'll literally build up to nothing, and no one ever emotes. Everyone has the same blank expression, and I never really know how to feel. The only time stuff happens is in like the last half hour of the movie, and by that time I already checked out. The whole movie just feels like it thinks it's cooler than it really is. My Letterboxd review says it all. Also, what kind of opening scene was that? And then I watched Another Round, and it was really good. It's one of those movies where it has no right to be as good as it is, but the movie handles this subject matter near perfectly. Because the movie mainly takes place from their perspective, it'll show us the elation they get while drunk, and then show us the damage it actually caused afterwards, and it causes a great amount of sympathy for each character. They just want to see if their boring lives will improve in any way, and in cases it does and in cases it doesn't. It's the chemistry between these friends that makes the movie. They legitimately feel like they've been friends for years, and you feel the love and care they have for each other. And what it all leads up to is one of my favorite movie moments of the year. It took me a little bit to fully get into this one, but once I was in, I was hooked. Then I rewatched Wonder Woman, and it's pretty good. It doesn't really hold up that much anymore, but it's still as empowering as it was back in 2017. The No Man's Land scene still stands the test of time, and the scene with the sniper still stands the test of time, but I couldn't help but to think that the action in this movie is nothing really new in terms of filmmaking. First off, it doesn't look good. It looks weirdly dark and over-reliant on CGI, but then they do the stupid slow-mo speed-up thing that was old when Gladiator and 300 did it. Second off, speaking of the CG, it looks like ass. I realize they need to use the CG, but like, they had the budget to make this look better. Also, I just don't think I'm a fan of Chris Pine. I don't think he's interesting. He just like... exists. Then I watched Songbird, and I never say this, but if you actually enjoy this movie, then you suck. Hey, here's an idea. How about we don't make a movie about a fucking pandemic in the middle of a fucking pandemic? It'd be fine if it at least brought some care into it, but no, they handle pandemics in the most ridiculous, goofiest way ever. It's actually pretty offensive. It's so clearly mocking the people actually afraid of what's going on. Every single thing about this movie is so over the top, and the way everyone acts makes no fucking sense. Whoever came up with the idea for this and greenlit it is an asshole. Yeah, let's just add to people's fears. And you know, even if it wasn't offensive, it would still be shit. Why does KJ Apa keep getting work? Why does he almost have the same name as me? Why does Paul Walter Hauser show up for no reason? What idiot would leave their ringer on when breaking into a home? Why is there no cohesive story? Why do we keep jumping from story to story to a point where it becomes a different movie? Why does every subplot suck? This movie is shit and Michael Bay is shit. It's shit. Everything is shit. Then I watched Saint Maud. This thing is nuts. I know a lot of people haven't seen this yet, so I may wait to do a formal review until everyone has seen it, because it's actually impossible to talk about this without spoiling. So I'll just repeat what I said on Letterboxd. Yo, for real, I could have followed this with a 2-hour long SpongeBob marathon, and it wouldn't do shit because I would still feel irreversibly traumatized after those last 10 minutes. Then I watched Freaky, and this movie fucking stinks. I absolutely love how people will complain about cringy jokes and dialogue, predictable storylines, and offensive stereotypes. Yes, the overly flamboyant gay best friend is still offensive, but then turn around and praise Landon's movies. Stop acting like this is in any way creative or original. I know everyone has a right to their opinion, but seriously, what is the appeal to this? What do you see? This is garbage! Is it a fun time? I don't really think so. I didn't really have fun. I laughed one time. I was bored all the way through. Also, stop acting like the ending isn't a problem. It's a huge problem and it makes zero sense. Sure, Vince Vaughn is fine. Catherine Newton, I guess this is her best performance, but like, I feel so bad saying this, but I don't think she's that good of an actress. She seems like such a cool person in real life, but like, I don't think she's that good at acting. Don't hate me, Catherine. I don't give a shit about anything that's going on. I don't give a shit about any of the characters. They're all cringe. Everything about this is cringe. What's the appeal to this? What's the appeal to Landon's movies? They suck. Then I watched But I'm a Cheerleader, and I screamed approximately 3 times. Women have been saving cinema since the beginning of time. Then I watched Wendy and Lucy, and it was fantastic. Kelly Reichardt is one of my favorite directors, and here she continues to prove how much she can do with so little. The feeling of dread and loneliness I felt throughout the whole thing is pretty unprecedented. It's a simple film, but it's also one of the most stressful ones out there. You immediately grow some sort of attachment to this woman and her dog, and in a weird way, relate. So when the plot kicks in, I couldn't help but to feel this sense of depression, but at the same time, this sense of engagement. And what I mean by that is everything is clearly meant to be painfully realistic, from how people react to certain situations, to the decisions that get made, to even the attachments that are here. It all adds to the emotional weight, and it's also beautiful. Reichardt always has a certain unique beauty in all of her films, and because of that, consider this one of my new favorite movies, and because of that, I'll probably cry every time I think about my dog now. Then I watched Gunda, and I'm counting this as a 2021 release so I can say that I already have a favorite movie of the year so far. Gunda provides us a perspective like no other. The perspective of a few different animals, how they go about their day, up to the night, but it's told in a sense through a 3-dimensional sound design and crystal clear, perfect cinematography, like we're watching someone or something we know live their daily lives. Someone or something who means a lot to us. Showing us that life can be simple, life can be difficult, but no one's lives are any different than how we live. This is definitive proof that so much can be said with so little. This is just the life of farm animals, and it's one of the most engaging things of the past few years. There are shots that will stick with me forever. Then I watched The Sunlit Night, and what the hell? This is pretty much a great movie disguised as a bad one. Like, the whole thing looks gorgeous, the acting is fine, and the score is honestly fantastic. I was never really bored throughout the whole thing, but it goes from like pure wholesome indie flick to pure ridiculousness that Jared Hess would be proud of really fast. And thankfully, I like Jared Hess, but that's beside the point. One of the very first scenes is Jenny Slate getting a leech pulled from her ass and her mom throws the leech on a fucking frying pan. Zach Galifianakis plays a guy from America who works at a Viking museum in Norway for some reason, so he wears Viking costumes all the time, and when you first meet him, you don't notice, so you greet to Zach Galifianakis just waltzing in dressed as a fucking Viking. It has no relevance to the plot, so there's no reason for Zach to dress as a Viking, but I am so glad that he did. I don't even know if they played this as a joke. That's just 2 points. I barely scratched the surface. This is basically At Eternity's Gate meets Napoleon Dynamite. And you know what, I'll be watching this a million times because I was entertained. Then I watched the Lizzie McGuire movie and no I didn't. This is what dreams are made of. But you know who did watch it? My good friend Steph Leone, her. Yeah, I'm just gonna take the time to throw a quick shout out to Steph because her and I have quickly become really good friends and she deserves the support. She does movie reactions and reviews and they're all great. So please subscribe to Steph and give her some love on her videos. Help her channel grow, she deserves it. She clearly works very hard and it shows. She's truly awesome, a great friend, and a certified queen. Then I watched The Lovebirds. I laughed maybe like 3 times, my dad laughed once, and my mom laughed like every joke was the funniest thing she ever heard in her life. Hey, note the comedy directors and editors, please learn how to fucking cut. Then I watched Elf. It's a Christmas classic, of course. It's still really funny, it probably always will be. I remember for some reason the scene where Buddy dances in the mailroom was the funniest thing in the world to me when I was a kid. And being an adult, it still cracks me up. Then I watched Wonder Woman 1984, and it was definitely a movie. Moving images were definitely projected onto a screen. There was acting, cinematography, music, and even editing. Out of all the movies I've seen in my life, this was definitely one of them. Was it good? Nope. I apply this to most comic book movies now, but I just didn't give a shit. Sure, the opening scene was cool, but then you realize it was kind of pointless. There's hardly any action for like 2/3 of the movie. The Wishing Rock subplot is so tired and formulaic. I felt zero tension throughout the whole thing. Kristen Wiig as Cheetah was hilarious. I just don't care. This movie just exists. It's on this planet. And like, I don't care. It's inoffensive, but it still kind of sucks. This tweet sums it up perfectly. Then I watched A Recipe for Seduction, the KFC movie, and it's everything I ever wanted out of life. Then I watched Clueless, and yep, you saw that right. 5 stars. I unapologetically love this. Clueless is such a clever satire to me. It takes every 90s trope and cliche and kind of turns it on its head, but never in a way where it felt too on the nose, and it never felt dated. At least for me. I know people who act like most of these characters, and instead of trying to overly exaggerate them, it kind of felt like a tribute to them. For every character, there was always a reason to love them, but it also balances their flaws perfectly. We see these characters at their most vulnerable and at their peak, and that's what makes this so engaging in my opinion. It has fun with every single idea that it has, and very clearly has this thought process of, how would this character react to this situation? Also, hot take, I think Cher might be my favorite character in any movie. And I wanted to save a special one for last. It involves another shoutout to one of my good online friends by the name of Asher Pike. He made an animated film and he did a really great job. It's called The King's World, Duel of Shades. and as you can see, it's one of the most uniquely animated films I've seen in a while. I truly haven't seen much out there like this, and he utilizes the animation in combination with the story and made it very engaging. You can tell with every frame how passionate he was about this, and how hard he worked. I couldn't imagine how long this must have took not only to animate, but to write. His dialogue, for the most part, feels very authentic for the time period it's meant to be set in, and just the genre in general. My only complaint is that it's so different in terms of presentation that it might confuse some viewers at first, but then you just start to get the hang of it and you'll understand what's going on. Also, the sound design isn't fantastic, but other than that, great job, Asher. I'm so excited to see you explode in the industry. I'll link his film in the description below. Please subscribe to him. He's a pretty awesome filmmaker and a great friend. Alright, that's what I watched in December. I know I kinda got too into it when talking about some of these films, but just remember this is all opinion based, and if you liked some of the films that I didn't and vice versa, that's totally fine, all the power to ya. I'm just some douchebag on the internet. In terms of what I'm doing next, I have a couple video essays in mind, and also I have a couple special videos that I have in mind. I'll keep those as a surprise. Anyway, look forward to what I'm doing next. I don't know when they'll be out, but they'll be out. Alright. Thanks, bye-bye.